Flying at 30,000 feet, you're higher than Mount Everest, a place where you would need an oxygen tank to breathe. So why don't you need one flying from New York to LA? Trace here for DNews, my frequently flying friends. As you go up higher and higher, the air pressure gets lower. The ratio of oxygen in the atmosphere does stay the same, but because of the lower pressure, the oxygen molecules spread out. Thus, at over 18,000 feet, there is less than half the oxygen that's available at sea level. Once you're over 25,000 feet, comfortingly called the death zone, plants no longer take root and most animals can't breathe at all. At death zone heights, oxygen levels are less than one-third what they are at sea level. Flying over 8,000 feet without modern technology can cause altitude sickness, or hypoxia, which results in headaches, dizziness, and eventually vomiting, fatigue, and difficulty thinking clearly. It's actually pretty serious. But the problem is, airplanes fly best high up in the air, and people breathe best nearer to the ground. So to compensate for that low pressure, low oxygen air, the airline industry invented pressurized cabins. Today, all commercial airlines have pressurized cabins to keep people breathing comfortably. But since they don't have tanks of air on board, they have to supplement the air in the cabin from some other source. Jet turbines sort of look like massive sets of fans, one after another, lots of different blades. Inside of that jet engine, air is spun through fan after fan, compressing it, causing it to heat up, before mixing it with some fuel to thrust the plane forward. Because it's compressed by the engines, it pushes the oxygen closer together, which is good for the jet because it can burn oxygen with fuel, but it also makes the air breathable for passengers inside. So before it's burned, some of that hot air is shunted away from the engine. This is called bleed air and sent into the airplane. It's still a little too hot to breathe though, between 200 and 250 Celsius. So it first heads into the wings to keep them from icing over and into the plane to keep it warm. Once that's done, the air is cooled to match the needs of the passenger so it can be mixed with the regular cabin air. And that's it, voila! Fresh outside air at altitude. The excess old air is vented through an outflow valve to keep the cabin pressure constant. Of course, there's an unfortunate side effect of all this. At high altitudes, humidity is really, really low, and after being heated and cooled a couple times, the air entering the plane is pretty much devoid of moisture. The World Health Organization says airplanes hover around 20% humidity. The driest place on Earth, Chile's Atacama Desert, has a humidity of 17.3%. Yikes. The thing is, it might dry your skin and your boogers, but dry air alone isn't gonna hurt you. And you do get some humidity from human breathing. Gross. New air is being brought in all the time throughout the flight, and by pressurizing the cabin and adding this fresh air, airplane manufacturers have been able to keep us cognizant and alive during multi-hour flights. Fun fact, if there is a failure in this system, those masks drop from the ceiling of the plane, and they are connected to a tank, which makes oxygen. Please put on your own mask before helping others, because at 30,000 feet, humans only have like 2 minutes of useful function without cabin pressure. Do you have a science question that we can answer here on DNews? We'd love to hear it. Let us know down in the comments. You can also subscribe here on DNews so you get more videos, or come tell us your questions over on Twitter. You can find the show at DNews. You can find me at Trace Dominguez.